We are now down to our last topic for the term. Ito na yung pinaka last lesson natin, and it is about how to generalize conclusions in psychological experiments. The first thing you need to remember about this lesson is this happens at the end of the experiment. Yung proseso ng pag-generalize ng conclusion, it happens towards the end. In fact, this is the phase where, as you can see on the screen, maraming mga estudyante ay masaya na because they are already done with the final project. But again, before you are done with the final project, you still need to discuss your conclusions, no? Kung saan ba natin pwedeng i-apply yung mga conclusions nyo, and that involves generalizing your conclusions. Pag-usapan muna natin, anong ibig sabihin ng salitang generalization? Generalization is a process where we apply principle, a truth, or an idea from one context to another context. Siguro para mas malinaw what this means, bigyan ko kayo ng isang maikling illustration on how generalization is done. Merong mga magkakaibigan na nag-uusap, no? They were talking about a girl. Oh. Sabi nung isa sa mga barkada, alam nyo si ganito, the name of the girl. She's a very interesting person. She's beautiful, she's smart. I like to pursue her. Sabi nung isa doon. And then one of the friends nagreply doon sa sinabi nung kanina. Sabi niya, "Oh, bro, okay naman sana siya. No, I agree with everything you said about the girl, but the problem is this girl is already taken." Oo, meron na raw siyang partner. Nasa relationship na raw siya. And then the other guy, yung kanina nagsalita, ang sabi niya, mas okay nga yun kasi ang nakataling manok ay madaling hulihin. Now, hindi naman joke yun eh. No, ano lang to? It is just a simple illustration. Huwag na natin pag-usapan kung tama ba yung kanyang generalization. But basically, yung ginawa nung guy when he said ang nakataling manok ay madaling hulihin, it is a form of generalization. Diba? Yung principle na totoo with chickens, which is ang nakataling manok, madaling hulihin, totoo yan with chickens, this guy applied it to human relationships. And by the way, what he meant was he is still going to pursue this girl because the girl and the guy are not yet married. Diba? Although they are in a relationship, oo, pero meron pa naman siyang pag-asa doon kasi hindi pa naman sila kasal. So again, let's not talk about whether you agree with that thinking or not, but that was generalization. What we believe to be true with chicken in the story, in the illustration, we applied it to human relationships. That's what you mean by generalization. Okay, now, let's go back to experimental psychology. Now that you know what generalization means, in experimental psych, what do we generalize? Basically, we generalize our conclusion. Meron tayong nakitang truth, meron tayong nakitang conclusion inside the laboratory. Diba? Ito na yung resulta mo ng pag-statistical analyze ng mga data mo, and then fast forward, you end up with a conclusion. This is what was seen to be true in my experiment. And then what do you do with that conclusion? You want to apply that in real life. In the first place, kaya ka nga nag-experiment. You are hoping that the truth or the conclusion you got from your experiment can be applied in everyday life. But remember this, when it comes to generalizing conclusions coming from your experiments, we start with this basic principle. We never apply to all population. Hindi natin ina-apply, and you should not attempt to apply a conclusion that you got from your experiment to all people. Hindi mo pwedeng sabihin na yung conclusion na nakita ko from my experiment applies to all human beings. Laging merong limitations yan. Your conclusion is only good or is only applicable to a certain small group in the population. Yung population, sabihin natin, ito yung human race o yung human beings. Your conclusion only applies to only some of those people in the population, not to everyone. It only applies to population violet, to population yellow, or to population orange. Diba? That's the basic principle you need to remember. There is no such thing as a universal application in psychological experiments. We only apply any conclusion that we get to a certain small group of people. Bigyan ko kayo ng halimbawa. What did Albert Bandura conclude from his very popular Bobo doll experiment? Ang sabi niya, based on that experiment, children who watch a violent model became violent. Yun yung nakita niya sa results niya. Therefore, in the experiment, he concluded that violence is something that is imitated. Kaya ang isang tao, especially ang bata, no, bakit siya violent? Meron siyang nakitang model in his life who is also violent. That is a very good conclusion to listen to, di ba? Pero ito ang tanong. Does this apply to all children? Going back to the previous slide na pinakita ko kanina, we don't apply this to all children. It only applies to certain groups of children, but not to all children. That's the limit of generalization. Diba? So, ito na ngayon ang tanong, no? Paano natin malalaman kung anong group of people nag-a-apply ang isang conclusion coming from a psychological experiment? How do we know who to apply the conclusion to? Kaya nga yung mga slides, yung slide ko dyan, yung mga bilog, if you can see the who. How do we know who is this small group of people to whom we can apply the conclusion that we got from our experiment? You have key questions to ask. Meron tayong mga katanungan na dapat nating sagutin to help us, to guide ourselves, kanino nag-a-apply yung mga psychological conclusions natin. The first question that you need to ask for you to determine kanino mag-a-apply ang conclusion is, who were the subjects? That's a very important question. Who were the subjects involved in the experiment? That's why it's very important for a psychological experiment to specifically identify the profile of the participants who were involved in the psychological experiment. Dapat aalamin nyo yung demographics. Ire-report ninyo sa methodology part ninyo yung overall demographics ng inyong mga participants. Let me demonstrate. Let's say, for example, in an experiment, merong conclusion, rock music causes high aggressive behaviors. Independent variable is rock music. Dependent variable is aggression. So, kayo nalang bahala mag-design. But to make the long story short, in the end, ito ang nakita nila. People who listen to rock music showed aggressive behaviors. Again, to whom do we apply this conclusion? Key question number one, sino ang mga taong involved in this experiment? Ano yung profiles ng mga tao na nakasama sa experiment na ito? Well, let's say for example, we went to the methodology part and then tinignan natin yung participants part. Diba? Usually in journal articles, doon nakasulat yung subject profile. And we saw, based on the methodology part, specifically the participants, that this experiment involved grade 2 male students. So, ano ang sagot? Kanina natin na-apply yung conclusion na ito. We only apply this to grade 2 male students. Rock music causes high aggressive behaviors only to who? Grade 2 male students. Right? Now, how about 40-year-old male engineers? Mag-a-apply ba yung conclusion na yan? Or to grade 4 male students, mag-a-apply ba yung conclusion na yan? The answer is no. That's why yung dalawang bilog na yon are in color red. Because we cannot apply that conclusion to those two subgroups. It only applies to the green one, the grade 2 male students. But what if I want to know if this conclusion also applies to 40-year-old male engineers or to grade 4 male students? Para malaman mo, ang gagawin mo dyan, ire-replicate mo. So you run the experiment again, And this time, you make your participants exclusively 40-year-old male engineers or grade 4 male students. But until you do, hindi mo pwedeng i-generalize yung conclusion na yan to 40-year-old male engineers or grade 4 male students. So I hope you can see here another purpose of replication. No, kung bakit ka nagre-replicate. We want to check how generalizable a conclusion is from a psychological experiment. So, one lesson that we can learn here na sana may-apply nyo in your original experiment, subject profile must be clearly defined. You really need to take seriously listing down the demographics of your participants at the planning stage of your experiment. Diba, bago ka palang gumawa ng experiment, kailangan malinaw na sa isipan mo kung sino lang ba yung mga tao na i-involve mo in your psychological experiment. Okay, that's why if you go to journal articles, ito, I just copy-pasted the participant section of a journal article. This is how detailed they are in reporting the demographics of the participants. Kung makikita nyo dyan, no? Talagang napaka-specific. Kaya mahaba yung part na yan in the methodology section of the article. Kasi you need to report almost all details about the demographics of your participants to help you identify kanino mo pwedeng i-generalize yung conclusion mo. Now, in relation to this subject profile, meron isang issue na dapat nating i-address in psychological experiments. Okay? Is it okay to generalize conclusions coming from animal experiments and apply it to human beings? Because if you have been reading some journal articles, especially in your majors, di ba? Meron tayo mga pag-aaral in psychology where the original experiment used animals as their participants. Behaviorism does a lot of these experiments, di ba? They experiment on dogs, pigeons, rats, at marami pang ibang mga animals. So, the question now is, whenever we make studies like this and we identify a conclusion, is it okay to apply that conclusion to human beings? Okay? So, let's answer that by starting with this example. There was a study done by a guy na may pangalang John Calhoun or Calhoun. I don't exactly know how do you pronounce this, no? But let's just call him John. Etong si John, meron siyang experiment aiming to answer the question, what is the effect of crowding on thinking and behavior? Yan yung kanyang question. Crowding, yung pagkakasikip-sikip ba ng mga tao, meron bang epekto yon sa thinking and behavior? So, he designed an experiment to answer this question, but he did not use human beings. He used rats. And I think it's very understandable bakit hindi siya gumamit ng tao, because, again, it's a question of ethics, right? I mean, it's not ethical for you to use human beings and crowd them together in a place and find out how will that affect them. Right? So, minsan kaya tayo gumagamit ng animal experiments, it's because of ethical issues. There are certain unethical procedures na magagawa tayo kapag gumamit tayo ng mga tao. That's why we consider experimenting on animals. So, going back to Calhoun's study, he studied rats. So, yung kanyang experiment, gumawa siya ng rat universe. Rat universe is like a very big place where he stored rats. Okay? So, yung rat universe, doon niya pinatira yung mga daga na pinag-aaralan niya. This is what it looks like. Okay? So, you can see there yung mga parang chambers, no? Doon niya nilagay yung mga rats. Tapos, yung center circle, dyan naman niya nilalagay yung food. Of course, to make the rats survive the experiment. Kasi the experiment needs a certain amount of time, no? Oo, para maging mag-run. Hindi lang siya isang araw. So, anyway, ano yung independent variable niya? Crowd density. gaano karami yung rats in the rat universe. He called that crowd density. There are two levels, not crowded and crowded. Now, let's no longer get into the specifics of the independent or to the levels of independent variable, but doon sa not crowded, ang nangyari dyan is he started the experiment with just few rats. How few is few? It was not reported in my source. Okay, basta he started with very few rats. Yung chambers na yan, hindi pa puno ng daga. But as time went by, they reproduced, dumami ng dumami until the number of rats reached a certain number that John Calhoun considered that already crowded. Gets? Okay, so ganyan yung design ng experiment niya, crowded and not crowded. The dependent, oh sorry, ito, look at this. Ito yung picture ni John Calhoun when he was still young and running the experiment. Oh, yan, no? Nagpa-picture siya dun sa chamber ng mga rats. Okay, pero hindi sinabi dito kung nasa anong level na siya dito, kung crowded na ba to or not yet crowded. Anyway, dependent variable in this experiment was dalawa. Number one, aggression levels, and number two, sexual behaviors. Okay, now you may ask, sir, pwede pala yun, dalawa yung dependent variable, pwede naman. Oo, but in your original experiment, I just ask you to pick one, but if you want to measure two things, pwede rin naman, kasi this can be considered as two separate studies. If you are going to publish this experiment, this can make two different papers. Diba? Yung crowding density to aggression levels, first paper, crowding density to sexual behaviors, second paper. Okay? So those are the two dependent variables that he wanted to measure in relation to crowding density. Ito na yung findings niya. Ano ang kanyang nakita? For the crowded condition, pag masyado ng maraming rats in the rat universe, he observed that a lot of rats displayed high levels of aggression. To be more specific, a lot of these rats, nakita niya, kinakain nila yung mga infant rats. So, ang dami-daming rats, ang sikip-sikip nila doon, no? Yung mga baby rats na binibreed pa lang o inaalagaan pa lang, stranger rats, yung mga ibang rats na galing sa ibang chamber, would barge into other chambers and begin eating the infant rats. Na hindi niya nakita when the rats were not crowded. They were not doing this when they were not crowded. And number two, John also saw a lot of abnormal sexual behaviors, especially among males, when nandoon na sa crowded level, diba? Such as what? A lot of the males, hindi na sila nagdi-display ng courtship behaviors towards females, which they did nung hindi pa ganun ka-crowded yung rat universe, no? A lot of these male rats, quote-unquote, sexually abused female rats. As in, hindi na sila nagpapakita ng courtship display. Basta trip nila yung female rat, they are going to copulate with the female rat, which is again, not observed when the rats were not crowded. Okay, so yun yung kanyang mga nakita. So tawag nga niya doon, nagkaroon ng parang rat rape, no? Siya lang naman yung nag-ano diyan, nag-coin sa term na 'yan. All right? Anyway, so what happened? Ito na yung conclusion niya. Of course, obviously, he concludes that crowding leads to immoral behaviors, bad behaviors among rats, 'di ba? Kumakain ka ng mga baby rats, nagiging aggressive ka, and then you are sexually abusing female rats. So these are negative behaviors to begin with. Now, the question is, to whom should we apply this conclusion? 'Di ba? Remember, ano yung unang tanong natin? Let's ask the question, who were the participants? In this study, rats. So one quick way to answer this question, to whom does this apply? It applies to rats. Pero ang second question now is, can we apply the same conclusion to human beings? Can we expect that humans, when they are crowded, will also show aggressive behaviors and sexual abuse? Right? So paano mo malalaman, is that conclusion generalizable to human beings? It all depends on your answer to this question. Okay? Yung psychological variable ba na pinag-aralan doon sa experiment is something similar or different between humans and animals. So if you want to know if a conclusion from animal study applies to human beings, tignan mo yung psychological variable na pinag-aralan. Yung psychological variable ba pareho between animals and human beings? If the psychological variable is highly similar between humans and animals, halimbawa, brain parts. Alam nyo ba, marami mga similarities ang utak ng tao at ng hayop. When you talk about the structures of the brain, very similar yung tao at saka sa hayop. I'm not saying it's exactly the same, but structurally speaking, there are a lot of similarities. Both animal and human brain, merong amygdala, merong hippocampus, merong cerebellum. And even the functions of these parts are very much the same between animal brain and human brain. Amygdala for emotions, hippocampus for memory, cerebellum for motor activities. Diba? So, very similar yan between animals and humans. Therefore, any conclusion that you get from brain studies of animals, more or less, can also be applied to the brain of human beings. That's why in biopsychology, marami talagang mga studies doon. Ang pinaka method is animal research. And they keep on showing that a lot of the things that they discover to be true on the animal brain are also true for the human brain. Diba? Kaya maraming mga animal experiments in the field of biopsychology or cognitive neuroscience. Another example is learning patterns. How people and animal learn. Actually, kung makikita nyo sa literature, the way animals learn are very much the same as how humans learn. Nadadaan tayo sa rewards and punishments. Nadadaan tayo sa reinforcements. Diba? Whenever, you know, how you teach a dog to sit or to stay, diba? Or to leave it or to go to the crate, very much the same principles we apply in teaching humans to learn certain subjects in school. Diba? Kaya maraming mga overlaps ang pag-aaral in the psychology of learning between animals and humans. Kaya nga kung titignan nyo yung learned helplessness, right? Learned helplessness is the popular study by Seligman on dogs, diba? Dogs become depressed when they find themselves in a hopeless situation. They learn how to be hopeless, diba? Based on their past experiences. Reviewin nyo na lang yung learned helplessness na study, no? But again, we can also apply the principles that we discovered, the truths we discovered from learned helplessness experiments to human beings. Because again, we are talking about learning patterns. How animals learn and how humans learn depression, very much the same. Therefore, it is acceptable to generalize conclusion from animal studies, specifically dogs, to humans when it comes to learned helplessness of depression. Okay? So, yan lang yung condition dito. Kapag highly similar yung psychological variable between humans and animals, we can generalize. On the other hand, if the psychological variable is definitely not similar or malayo between animals and humans, then definitely we cannot generalize. Some examples of psychological variables that are definitely far away between animals and humans would be, number one, sexual behaviors and decision making. Although animals or although human beings also have sex, I mean, part din yun ng kanilang biological functioning, but the way human beings do sex or see sex is very different from how animals do it. Diba? I mean, there is a big discrepancy between animal sex and human sex. Diba? Kaya, in that case, if you run an experiment on sexual behaviors of animals, you should not generalize that to sexual behaviors of humans or even decision making. Although animals also can make decisions, But the way animals make decisions, very different from how humans do it. Humans are more cognitive in making decisions. Animals, very instinctive in making decisions. So when you run an experiment on animal decision making, you should not generalize that conclusion to human beings' decision making. So those are the conditions that to consider before you apply conclusions from animal studies to human studies. Now, another way, ito yung tanong, no? How can you know if a certain psychological variable is similar or not between animals and humans? We go back again to the review of literature. The literature will tell you which psychological variables are very much connected or are very much the same between animals and humans and which variables are not. Kaya again, in this case, napakahalaga pa rin na i-expose nyo yung mga sarili nyo in the review of your literature. Okay, so going back to the study by John Calhoun, can we generalize his conclusions to human beings? Again, ano yung mga dependent variables dito? Aggression levels and sexual behaviors. Ito yung mga tinitignan niya. So the question now here is, let's apply the principle. Can we generalize what he observed to human beings? Diba? Oh, ang gagawin mo dyan, malayo ba o malapit yung aggression between animals and humans? Malayo ba o malapit yung sexual behaviors between rats and humans? Oh, for the first one, aggression levels, the answer is yes. You know, animal aggression, specifically even rat aggression, very much the same as human aggression. Diba? Maraming similarities ang animal aggression sa human aggression. Therefore, in this case, you can generalize that conclusion to human beings. Pero pagdating sa sexual behaviors, yung nakita natin kaninang nagsasexually abuse yung mga male rats, no? It seems like medyo alalay or i-avoid natin to generalize that conclusion. Because again, how animals have sex, yung mga sexual practices nila, malalayo sa mga sexual practices ng mga tao. Diba? So in that case, medyo dapat mag-aalangan ka or you are going to hesitate or to even avoid generalizing that conclusion from rats to human beings. Oh. Pero kung talagang gusto mong malaman kung would we see the same conclusion when we use human beings, replicate the study using human beings. Pero, ang problema nga dyan is, masasagasaan mo yung ethical standards natin. Diba? So, may mga experiments talaga na sadyang there's no way to do it but to use animal studies. Oo, para ma-avoid natin yung pag-violate ng ethical standards. Now, let's go to the third key question on generalizing conclusions. What was the task in the experiment? So dito, lumipat na tayo ng focus, no? Kanina we focus more on the who of the experiment. Dito naman we focus on the what. What was the task done in the original experiment? Okay? Siguro para mas malinaw, bigyan ko kayo ng isa pang study that addressed this concern. This study was designed or was carried by Siegert et al. And what's interesting on this study is they did it in a railroad station o estasyon ng tren. Okay? So basically, ang question lang naman nila is about crowding. Parang, yeah, crowding din. And they want to know whether crowding will affect human physical performance. Actually, kung medyo nawiwiaduhan kayo sa topic nila, these are the kinds of topics that we study in human factor psychology. We study the interaction between the technology or the environment to the human beings. Ano ang relationship ng technology or the overall environment to human beings? Human factor psychology yan. Okay, so yan yung kanilang tanong. Meron bang epekto yung pagka-crowd sa human physical performance ng mga tao, no? So they did the study using between subjects design. Paano niran yung experiment? Independent variable nila, crowd density. Levels, two levels, high density and low density. Now, yung high density, ibig sabihin yan, maraming tao. That's why they did the experiment during rush hour in a train station. I think this is in the United States. So, yung high density, they carried out the experiment during the rush hour in the railroad station where they did the experiment. Yung low density naman, they did the experiment during the time where most people are at work. Kumbaga sa Tagalog, ito yung patay na oras, di ba? So, in this experiment, they gave their participants list of physical tasks to complete within the train station. So, all tasks that they asked the participants to do can be completed within the train station. So, yung first group, they did this task in a high density situation, the second group in a low density situation. Dependent variables, dalawa ulit, number of tasks that they were able to complete, and the total amount of time that it took them to complete the task. Mukhang dito pa lang, alam mo na yung magiging findings, eh, di ba? So, ano yung mga findings na nakita nila? Number one, obviously, and not surprisingly, more tasks were completed under the not crowded level. Obvious ba? Diba? So, mas mabilis silang natapos, mas marami silang na-accomplish when there are not a lot of people in the train station. And again, not surprisingly, there was more time consumed, mas konti yung nagawa nilang mga task when they did the task in the crowded situation. So, ang conclusion niya, again, not surprisingly, crowding slows down human physical performance. Talaga? Oo, parang ngayon ko lang nalaman yan. Obviously, crowding slows down human physical performance. Now, ito na ngayon. Ang tanong, now that we know a certain truth about crowding, that it slows down human performance, to what situation in real life, to what tasks in real life, can we apply this principle? Definitely, it applies to physical tasks. Diba? Kaya, ang conclusion dito, ang application dito, kung meron kang ipapagawa sa mga tao mo at gusto mong mabilis silang matapos, don't let them do those tasks, the physical tasks, during a crowded situation. Diba? Oo, wag mo silang ipagawa ng mga tasks na yun sa maraming tao. Very basic. But here's a deeper question. Can we say the same when it comes to mental tasks? Halimbawa, is it right to also conclude that the way or your ability in calculating things is also affected by crowding? Again, the question is, what was the original task in the experiment? In the original task na diniscuss ko kanina, the task that was practiced or that was applied in the original experiment was very physical. Physical task, di ba? Hindi siya mental. Therefore, to the question, ma-apply ba natin itong truth na ito in doing mental tasks such as mental calculation? May epekto ba yung crowding? Kapag maraming tao ba, tapos doon ka nag-compute ng mga mathematical problems, maaapektuhan ba yung performance mo? Or let's say, may epekto ba yung crowding sa paglalaro mo ng chess? The answers to those questions is, we don't know. We cannot generalize that truth that we discovered from experiments on physical tasks. Diba? Kasi nga, magkaiba yung physical task sa mental task. So, that truth, that conclusion only stays to the physical task but not on mental task. What if you want to know kung mag-a-apply din ba yan sa mental task? Anong gagawin mo? Well, you run another study. Ire-replicate mo. This time, yung task magiging mental na. Okay? Let's apply that principle in this exercise. In one experiment, it was observed that having a rock music background better enhanced a group of working adults' numerical problem-solving tasks in the lab than a control group who did not have music background at all. So parang usapin ito kung effective ba yung may background music ka habang nagtatrabaho, no? At dito pinag-aralan yung background music mo is rock music. Effective daw yung performance ng mga tao when the background, when there is rock music in the background, okay? Doing numerical problem solving task. Now, given this conclusion, sagutin niyo yung yes or no. Would you recommend to play rock music in banks, mga bangko? Can you imagine that? Pumasok ka ng isang bangko tapos yung background nila rock music, di ba? Well, sabi kasi sa experiment, ganun eh, di ba? What questions about this experiment would you ask before you decide to play or not to play rock music in banks? So, we just go back, no, to the principle that we are talking about. Let's talk about the task. Wag na muna natin i-apply dito yung the who. Okay? Yung task muna. You go back to the original experiment at ano yung pag-aaralan mo. Tignan mo kung ano ba yung numerical problem solving task na ginawa in the laboratory. You need to revisit that. Go to the methodology part and then look for that task, the description of that task, kung ano ba yung pinagawa doon sa numerical problem solving task. And then you analyze whether that task is very similar to what people do in banks, to what tellers do in banks. So, masasabi mo pang comparable yung ginawa doon sa laboratory sa ginagawa ng mga tellers doon sa bangko? If your answer is yes, pareho naman ng nature, no? Yung task between the laboratory and the bank, you can do this. But if your answer is no, mukhang doon kasi sa laboratory, nag-solve lang sila ng college algebra problems. That does not happen every day inside a bank if you are a teller. I mean, kapag teller ka, you don't solve algebra problems. Diba? You solve money problems, financial problems. You interact with people. Diba? That's what tellers do. So in that case, malayong malayo yung nature ng task between the laboratory and the bank. Therefore, you should hesitate applying this conclusion to the bank. Diba? But if you really want to know kung meron ba talagang good effect yung rock music sa performance ng mga bank tellers, then you run an experiment using bank tellers. Better, bank tellers within a bank in a typical day. Diba? So magkakaroon ka na ngayon ng parang social experiment, no, where you are running an experiment in the context of everyday life. Pero ang problema doon, of course, you will disrupt real life transactions, eh. Diba? I mean, you cannot just select a bank and then force them to play the rock music and then measure how their tellers are performing. Diba? Kaya again, ang best bet mo talaga dito is you put this situation in a laboratory. I-play mo pa rin yung rock music in the laboratory and then this time using bank tellers doing things that bank tellers really do in real banks para malaman mo if this conclusion is generalizable to the real life. Okay? So in summary, as we end our lesson for today, ano yung mga key questions that you need to ask before generalizing a conclusion in a psychological experiment? Number one, who were the subjects? Number two, yung variable ba na pinag-aaralan mo is similar or different between animals and humans if you are dealing with animal studies? And number three, what was the task that was performed in the laboratory? You compare that to the task that is being performed in everyday life. Now, meron pa akong isa dito, pang-apat. Ito yung parang ano ko, no, wait, there's more ko. Okay? Are your participants representative of a population? That is another very important question that you need to ask before you generalize a conclusion to real life? Are your participants representative of a population? We always encounter this problem in survey research, lalong-lalo na kapag election. In fact, maraming mga kandidato sa election, no? Medyo nirereklamo yung mga survey research na yan. Let's say, for example, naglabas ang isang survey, ang isang company. Ang sabi nila, 76% of Filipinos are satisfied with our president, 11% are dissatisfied, and 13% are undecided. Okay, so yun yung mga numbers. Again, this is survey research. Mamaya, i-apply natin to sa experiment research, no? The question now is, ito yung dapat mong tanungin. Do the respondents in this survey research represent the Filipino nation? That's a very critical question. When you read survey researches like this, tatanungin mo kung yung 76%, 11%, 13% ba na yan represent the Filipino population. Diba? Kasi if definitely this research is for Filipinos, gusto natin malaman kung ano ang napupusuan, kung sino ang napupusuan ng mga Pilipino. Therefore, when you say 76% of them approve of our president, the next question is, sino ba yung mga participants dyan? Yung mga participants ba dito na represent yung Filipino nation? Because remember, ang Filipino, hindi lang puro taga Metro Manila. Ang Filipino, anyone who lives somewhere in Luzon, in Visayas, and in Mindanao, is considered a Filipino. Kaya nga, going back to the survey research na prinesent ko kanina, it is very important that whoever ran this study practiced what we call a stratified random sampling. Medyo technical nang iintindihin kung paano gawin ang stratified random sampling, but the bottom line of this sampling method is, in that survey, if they did it right, meron silang mga participants na sumagot sa survey nila coming from Luzon, merong coming from Visayas, merong coming from Mindanao. Gets? That's stratified random sampling. Hindi pwedeng magre-release ka ng survey results tapos ang sampling method mo convenience lang. Lahat pala ng tinanong mo sa Metro Manila. Can you imagine? Lahat ng participants mo sa survey from Metro Manila, pero naglabas ka ng survey results like this saying that this is what Filipinos think about our president. That's not fair. Kasi hindi mo na na-consider yung mga iniisip ng mga tao sa Visayas, ng mga tao sa Mindanao. Eh, ang pagka-Pilipino, Luzon, Visayas, Mindanao yan. So, if you are going to do this survey research right, you need to have a respondent from the three major areas in the Philippines. Diba? Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao. That is why, in connection to this, sana ma-realize nyo how important it is for us to practice random sampling in experiments or even in social science research in general. Remember the idea of random sampling? Everyone had a chance to be a part of your study. Everyone. Ang maganda sa random sampling kasi when you practice random sampling, di ba, nag-random ka sa Luzon, nag-random ka sa Visayas, nag-random ka sa Mindanao, you become more confident in generalizing the truth that you will get later on in your experiment. Kasi confident ka that more or less, you were able to get what people what people think about because you practice random sampling. Pero yung convenient sampling like what originally experiment, medyo nag-aalin na yung behavior has a hesitation. We are not confident to generalize our results because we are not confident. Or because we did not ask all Filipinos. We did not ask all students in LaSalle. We did not ask all college students. Kasi nga sa setup natin, it's lockdown. It's very hard to practice random sampling. So I just allowed you to do a non-random sampling, specifically convenience sampling. Okay? Okay, so napakahalaga ng random sampling in the process of doing psychological experiment. Now, you translate that in experiment. O, bigyan ko kayo ng topic, no? Halimbawa, ito yung topic mo. Does K-drama increase the well-being of Filipinos? Now, this time, let's do an experiment. Imagine nyo, you are going to do a within subjects design. So, select a group of Filipinos, and then you study their dependent variable, which is their well-being. Independent variable, K-drama. Ang panonood ba ng K-drama nakakapag-increase ng well-being? Now, fast forward. Kayo na lang bahala mag-design, kayo na lang bahala mag-run ng experiment, no? Pero halimbawa, fast forward natin yung experiment, ito yung conclusion mo. K-drama does increase the psychological well-being of Filipinos. Okay? Yun yung conclusion mo. Lumabas P less than 0.05, so you are so happy, right? Na reject mo yung null hypothesis mo. Next question. Does this apply to all Filipinos? Tama? Does this apply to all Filipinos? What would you review? If you want to know kung nag-a-apply ba yung conclusion na ito sa lahat ng Pilipino, ano yung kinakailangan mo reviewin in your experiment? You need to review, of course, again, the who. Diba? Sino yung mga involved sa experiment mo? Is this representative of the Filipino population? Baka naman yung mga tinanong mo dito, mga taga-Luzon lang, mga taga-NCR lang, yung mga friends mo lang. Oh, maybe K-drama does not affect well-being for people in Visayas or for people in Mindanao. Maybe they have a different interest other than K-drama. Oh, again, we wouldn't know. Kaya nga, again, ang re-reviewin mo dito, sino yung mga tao na involved in this experiment? Do they represent all Filipinos? Do you have participants in your experiment coming from Luzon, coming from Visayas, coming from Mindanao? If your answer is no, lahat ng participants mo taga-Luzon lang, then what do you do? This conclusion is only applicable to Filipinos in Luzon. So, ganun dapat yung presentation mo ng paper mo. Diba? K-drama increases psychological well-being only for Filipinos in Luzon. But for Visayas, for Mindanao, we still don't know. Ganon ang rule, you know, in generalizing conclusions in psychological experiment. Pero ito kasi, no, I also hope na, oh wait lang, meron akong typo dito, dapat pala ito purpose. No, palitan na natin ngayon, purpose. I also want you to realize, given all these things I'm talking about, generalization in psychological experiment, ito pa yung isang reason kung bakit tayo sumusulat ng limitations in experiment. Diba? Kasi one of the reasons bakit ka susulat ng limitations, it's because dito mo na ngayon sasabihin sa mga readers mo kung hanggang saan lang yung limit ng pag-a-apply mo ng iyong conclusion. By the way, no, limitations in general, dyan din sinusulat yung mga, ayan, yung nasa slide nyo, unexpected events na nangyari in your experiment na posibleng naka-apekto sa outcome ng experiment nyo. Possible extraneous or confounding variables, ilalagay nyo rin yan sa limitations nyo. Kapag yung mga instruments nyo self-made lang, in other words, it is not standardized, self-constructed lang, hindi nyo naman chinek kung reliable ba or valid yung instruments nyo. Hindi nyo rin ilalagay yung number of participants, no, as limitations. Yung sasabihin nyo dyan na masyadong konti. Because remember, in experiments, given the number of your levels, meron yang appropriate number of participants, no? Nako-compute yan sa Google. May mga websites that can compute how many participants should you have given the number of your IV levels. Pero hindi ko na pina-require sa inyo yon kasi nga because of our situation. Okay? Pero dun yun nga rin ilalagay yan. Sasabihin nyo doon na masyadong konti yung participants namin to to come up with a confident conclusion, something like that. And of course, yung nasa red one, dito nyo na ilalagay sa limitations yung uncertainty if your conclusion applies to a certain group of people. So, ang gagawin nyo sa limitations is, ire-report nyo yan. Ngayon, conclusion namin, hanggang dito lang sa mga taong ito. Okay? If you want to know whether this experiment, whether this conclusion of our experiment also applies to other groups of people, future researchers can work on that. Yun naman yung ilalagay nyo sa recommendations part. Diba, magkasunod yan, you know? Limitations and then recommendations. Alright? Now, in closing, last na talaga to, no? I just want to relate our topic on generalization on COVID-19 vaccine. Kasi nga, di ba ganyan ako magturo? Gusto ko yung mga pinag-aaralan natin sa classroom and nako-connect natin sa ating everyday life. Okay? So, again, to make the long story short, meron ng mga nagpe-present ng vaccine sa atin. Basically, ang sinasabi lang naman nila is, ano ba yung conclusion from these vaccines? The conclusion is, these vaccines can kill COVID-19 virus. That's the conclusion, right? Just like any other conclusions that we get from psychological experiments, these vaccines can kill COVID-19. Now, what should be your response? If you know experimental psychology, if you have a scientific attitude, dapat ang response mo hindi hallelujah. Okay? Dapat ang response mo is with skepticism. Wait lang. Yan. Hindi dapat hallelujah, no? Oo. Huwag ka muna magdiwang kasi nag-aral ka ng experimental psychology. You know the process of experiment. So bakit ka mag-wait lang? Ano bang meron? Ano pa yung mga dapat mong itanong before you can say or before you decide to let these vaccines inside your body? Oh, ganito yan. Meron kayong mga naririnig na mga numbers. Like for example, Pfizer. Pfizer is very proud of their numbers, right? They're reporting that their efficacy rate is somewhere between 90 to 95%. Kaya nga among the different options, a lot of people want Pfizer inside their bodies kasi ito ang pinakamataas na efficacy rate. Now, this in itself, kung mapapansin ninyo, yung 95% na yan, ito yung parang data that they have to support the conclusion that their vaccine is effective. Diba? Again, ano yung conclusion nila? This vaccine that we have is effective. Ano yung backup nila? Ano yung basis nila for saying that we have a 95% efficacy rate? But remember, this efficacy rate came from who? Came from the people that they have studied in the past. So they got a certain number of people, tinurukan ng Pfizer, compared them to those people na hindi tinurukan ng vaccine or placebo, and it turned out 95% efficacy rate. So yan yung kanilang pinaka data to prove, to convince people that this vaccine is effective. But now that you have watched this video, apply mo yung mga principles sa pinag-aralan natin. What would we like to know first before we believe that these vaccines are really effective? Number one, syempre, ang pinaka-importante, who were the participants during the trials? That's what you want to know. Sino muna yung pinagmulan ng 90 to 95% na yan? I mean, if we're talking about Pfizer, kasi iba-iba yata yung efficacy rate ng iba't ibang mga vaccines. But regardless, that's a very important question to ask. Sino muna? Sino yung mga involved in the clinical trials of these vaccines? Diba? Oh, gusto mong malaman kung yung mga tao ba na involved doon sa clinical trials are very much similar to Filipinos. Kaya ngayon ang dapat mong itanong eh, meron bang mga Pilipino, kung ikaw man ay Pilipino, no? Oh, kung meron bang mga Pilipino na sinama doon sa mga clinical trials ng mga vaccines na yan? Exactly how many Filipinos were there? You need to know that, right? And these companies need to report that in our clinical trials, Filipinos were also included. Diba? That will make you more confident na, maybe the vaccine really works. Kasi, sa clinical trials nila, ang daming mga Pilipino na nasama at wala naman nangyari sa kanila, maybe it does work. But until they show that, you need to have a very skeptic attitude to the vaccine. Kaya nga kung mapapansin ninyo no, sa mga news, as you can see on the screen, di ba meron tayo mga paambon-ambon na mga clinical trials here in the Philippines. Di ba? Sinovac, Janssen, AstraZeneca, they want to have clinical trials here in the Philippines. Alam niyo bakit? Ano yung purpose niyan? So that they can be sure that their conclusion that their vaccine is effective can be generalized to the Filipino population. Kaya sila kumukuha ng mga participants dito sa Pilipinas. That's the reason why they want to run experiments in the Philippines. So that they will have Filipino population in their experiment so that later on, they can conclude that this vaccine is also generalizable or is also effective for Filipinos. Pero yun nga ang nakakatakot, no? If I'm not mistaken, just correct me if I'm wrong, no? Doon sa comment section nito, ang majority talaga ng mga clinical trials ng Pfizer, let's just talk about Pfizer, is Westerners. Again, I'm just assuming, no? Kasi ang Pfizer, talagang Western company yan, so it makes sense na yung kanilang mga participants, mga Westerners. Does that vaccine apply to non-Westerners? Does that apply to Asians? Does that apply to Australians? Does that apply to other continents that are not considered the West? Right? Can they generalize the effectiveness of their vaccine to the entire human population? Now, some of you may ask, really? Iniisip ba talaga yan? Yes. Maybe some of you may say, aren't we all human beings naman, sir? Bakit hindi na lang natin paniwalaan yung 95% ng Pfizer so that everything can go back to normal? Aren't we all humans? Ano ang sagot sa argument na yan? Yes, it is indeed true that we are all human beings. But even if all of us are human beings, there are a lot of things within our humanity that makes us different from each other, which may question the effectiveness of any, hindi lang Pfizer, of any vaccines that will be presented to us. Lahat ng vaccines na ipipresenta sa atin, we need to really become skeptical. How generalizable is the good effect of their vaccine to human beings? After all, yes, we are all human beings, but yung effectiveness ba ng vaccine is generalizable to all people with different pre-existing conditions? People differ in their body chemistry. And that is partially determined by our diet, which is determined by culture. Iba-iba tayo ng mga kinakain. Iba ang kinakain sa Amerika. Iba ang kinakain sa Russia. Iba ang kinakain sa Pilipinas. And these foods that we eat may alter our body chemistry. Now, yung vaccine ba na yan, is it good for all types of body chemistries? We differ in our climate. We differ in our blood types. We differ in our age groups. O, diba, lalong-lalo na yung age group na yan, diba, naririnig nyo ba yung mga balita na maraming mga trials na namamatay yung mga matatanda when they are given the vaccine? Oh, maybe the vaccine is only effective for a certain age group but not effective for certain age groups. Now, which groups are that? Kinakailangan, klaro na naman yan. Oh, bago natin tanggapin yung mga vaccines na yan. Diba? Sa Norway, nangyari yan eh. Right? Yung maraming namatay because of the vaccine, maybe the vaccine works for younger people than not for older people. We really need to revisit the studies that was done by these vaccine companies. Diba? Pero, ito na nga. If you don't want to be this skeptical, Kasi parang sinasabi mo na ang dami-dami namang iniisip. Gusto ko nang matapos to. Gusto ko nang lumabas. Gusto ko nang bumalik sa dati. Well, there's another alternative. Sabi nga dyan sa slide, you can risk. Diba? E di wag mo na lang antayin yung data. You just risk. And a lot of people have already risked. They have already taken the vaccine. They have already volunteered to take the vaccine. Diba? So it's now up to you if you are going to risk taking the vaccine or wait for other data to come. Meaning, ano yung wait for other data? Let's wait kung anong mangyayari sa mga taong naturukan na. I mean, we wouldn't know. Remember, this is the vaccine na sa history ng mundo, pinakamabilis na develop. So when we talk about the number of data that we have to really conclude that the vaccine is effective, to really conclude that it is effective to all people, medyo kulang pa yung data. But then again, this is a free country. That is your body. It's up to you if you're going to wait for the data or to risk. Okay, so sana may natutunan kayo sa ating last lesson on how to generalize conclusions in experimental psychology. So after this lesson, meron pa akong isang video na i-upload, but that video is no longer connected to any lesson, but it's about how to complete your final output in experimental psychology. So I hope you like this video. Mag-comment kayo sa baba ano, if you have any questions or if you have any comments about anything I mentioned in this video. Thank you for listening and